Well, welcome to the last session of our symposium on racist stereotypes and cultural appropriation in American sports. Today, what we'll be closing the symposium with is a community conversation about the Washington NFL football team name. My name is Phil Deloria. I'll be the moderator for the panel today. I'm a professor of history and American studies at the University of Michigan and the associate dean for undergraduate education. My scholarly work has to do with cultural appropriations and representations of American Indian people in the broader world of American culture. We have five distinguished guests with us today. I'm going to say only a very few quick words of introduction. I think some of their comments will perhaps lead you to know more and understand more about them. Judith Bartonoff, Esquire, the deputy presiding judge of the Civil Division of the District of Columbia Superior Court, attended Columbia University Law School, worked in the U.S. Attorney's Office for the District of Columbia, was the Justice Department representation on a task force concerned with American Indian religious freedom issues, has worked with the Navajo tribe in private practice for a few years in 1994, then moved to the bench as an associate judge, and now, of course, deputy presiding judge. To her left, Mr. Eric Brady, sports reporter, USA Today. He's been active over a three-decade career since 1982 doing features. He's written on everything in sports, as far as I can tell. When you Google him, what you get is a page that has links to all of his clips, and it has it's not one page, it's 64 pages long. So he's written on everything, including football and including some of these issues. To his left, the Reverend Graylin Hagler of Plymouth Congregational United Church of Christ. He's the immediate past president of Ministers for Racial, Social, and Economic Justice, received his Master's of Divinity degree from Chicago Theological Seminary, 12 years as a pastor in Boston committed to empowerment, opposition to racism, anti-apartment movements. He even ran for mayor while he was there. To his left, Mike Wise, sports columnist at the Washington Post. He's been a writer at the New York Times. He's examined the mascot issue in several thoughtful, well-written pieces, has considered team names and mascots not only here, but in Illinois and elsewhere. And finally, to his left, Robert Holden, who's the deputy director of the National Congress of American Indians. He's Choctaw Chickasaw, active in a number of issues in American Indian country. He was very active with post-Katrina, Louisiana tribes, for example, environmental, emergency issues, sacred sites, voting issues, ranging across the board Native American issues. So what our panelists will do is speak to us for somewhere in the range of 7 to 10 minutes, not really very long. What we're really trying to do here is to balance the expertise that we have on stage with the notion that we can have more of community conversation here. So each will speak for from somewhere in the 7 to 10 minute range. That gets us, you know, kind of closing up on an hour. It leaves us about an hour to talk collaboratively and collectively about this as an audience. Just to lay down a couple of quick ground rules for when we move to that community conversation. First of all, everyone who would like to ask a question or make a short statement should move to the microphones at the back. We're doing this because, of course, our session today is being webcast, and it's also being webcast up to another room where I had the pleasure of watching a little bit of it this morning. You know, please just think a little bit about our opportunities, if this is our situation, to maximize the conversation, to maximize the number of voices. You know, I'm in a university context. A lot of times we have this exact setup with a microphone in the back, and, you know, every once in a while someone will get up and want to talk for 15 minutes, and it's just not really very good for anyone. It's sort of, that's a quarter of our collective time, right? Yeah. If four of us did it, only four people would talk. We'd rather hear more kinds of voices. It makes everyone a little nervous and itchy to have this going on. So try to, you know, be sort of aware of, you know, the fact there may be many, many people who would like to, might like to speak on these issues. I'll say a few words in closing, and then we'll have a delightful reception, I believe, out in the front. The atrium part of the museum. So with that, I will turn to Judith Bartonoff. Please make her welcome.
Thank you very much. It is a real honor to be here. You're going to hear that, I'm sure, from each one of the panelists. Let me begin by making it clear that I'm not here in any official capacity representing the Superior Court of the District of Columbia. My comments this afternoon should not be taken as any official position of the court on the issues we're discussing. But I am here as a longtime resident of the District of Columbia, and my experiences as a judge on our local trial court for the past 18 years certainly do inform my perspective. The primary point I want to make to begin our discussion today is that the District of Columbia is a real place. Those of us who live here understand that for much of the country, the district is the nation's capital, a place where people may come for a short time to serve in the government, or a place with marble monuments and museums for tourists to visit. But for many of us, the district, and in saying the district, I mean the surrounding communities as well, the district is our home. It's where we live, work, go to school, the grocery store, and the dry cleaner, and the doctor, and the movies. It's where we conduct our day-to-day lives. The Superior Court itself is emblematic of that. Because of the unique laws establishing the district's government, it is a federal court, and our judges are nominated by the president and confirmed by the Senate. We also, by the way, are required by federal law to live in the District of Columbia, which is not a requirement for judges on the U.S. District Court for the District of Columbia. What Superior Court judges deal with every day reflects the regular life of the city. Everything from simple assaults to drug deals to murders, divorces, protection of children and the elderly, car accidents, landlord and tenant matters, consumer complaints, tax liens, and all sorts of other things in the you can't make this stuff up category. So I start from the premise that the district is not just the nation's capital, but a real place. And there are no symbols more important as a unifying force in the District of Columbia and confirmation that this is a real place than our local sports teams. We do have a soccer team, a hockey team, and a basketball team, and thank goodness now a baseball team. But there's no real question that the most prominent symbol of the real Washington is the local football team. A symbol, by the way, that is also unites the Washington and the adjoining Maryland and Virginia suburbs. I well remember an article that appeared in the Washington Post in the early 80s when the local football team finally had made it to the Super Bowl. The article said essentially that the team being in the Super Bowl had special importance to the district because it was proof to the rest of the country that this is a real place. The football team has become a symbol of our legitimacy as a community. Last fall, my husband and I attended what turned out to be, unfortunately, the last playoff game for the season for the Nationals. The feeling of being in the stadium with over 40,000 people all screaming at the top of their lungs was both exhilarating and, I will confess, a little bit scary. But part of what was so exciting about it was that we all were there, that is, with the exception of a few lone Cardinals fans, including one very loud one near us, and I'm happy to say that nothing bad happened to him, though I was a little bit worried about it. We all were there as equals and Nationals fans, and no one cared if there were celebrities or politicians there, too. They were welcome to join the party, but it was our party until it stopped being a party. This was our team that was on its way to the World Series, even though, as it turned out, we may have to wait another year. I can only imagine what it would be like to be at a football game at FedEx Field in a crowd of closer to 90,000 people, all screaming at the top of their lungs, when what they are screaming is a racial slur. I will leave it to others to discuss the sociological and psychological impact of all this, and I expect that we'll be addressing some of those issues in this panel this afternoon. But I do think there is something both troubling and anomalous that perhaps the strongest unifying symbol of the Washington, D.C. community and the most tangible proof that this is a real place is called by a name that is disrespectful and derogatory to Native people. What we can do about that may be an open question, but I don't think we seriously can claim anymore that it isn't true, and to the extent we don't acknowledge it, we're in serious denial. This is a community that includes people from all sorts of cultures and backgrounds, and I think we all recognize the importance of treating one another with dignity and respect. That our most powerful unifying symbol is directly opposed to those basic values undermines the community itself, and that warrants serious reflection and conversation.
When I was a sports mad kid growing up in Buffalo, Saturday nights were always reserved for the college basketball doubleheaders at the big arena downtown. The local Catholic schools were the Canisius College Golden Griffins, the Niagara University Purple Eagles, and the St. Bonaventure Brown Indians. The teams played and the mascots pranced, and it all seemed like so much magic to a boy who would one day grow up to be a sports writer. In my mind's eye, I can still see that cloud of cigarette smoke that would form in the rafters as the nights wore on, in an era when that seemed more atmospheric than carcinogenic. My father was a professor of English at Canisius, and so the Griffins were our team. But we always watched the Eagles and the Indians, our great local rivals, with enormous interest, if not always, great affection. The most common nickname in college sports is Eagles, as at Niagara. The seventh most common in those days was Indians, as at St. Bona, though when all such mascots were grouped together, from Braves to Chiefs to Warriors, those nicknames were the most common in all the land. And this seemed natural enough to me. Our Buffalo Bills played against the Kansas City Chiefs. Our morning paper carried headlines about the Cleveland Indians that would say the likes of Tribe on Warpath, Scalp Yanks, and Twin Bill. And then, when I was in grammar school, my sister Moira began dating a man named John Roberts, whose maternal grandfather was Seneca. Moira and her future husband would take my brother and me to the college doubleheaders, and it was John who'd take us aside and point to the student dressed as the Bonaventure mascot and explain why a drunken white kid whooping it up in buckskin and war paint was so deeply objectionable on so many levels. A lot has changed since then. There's no smoking in public arenas anymore, and the Brown Indian is long gone. St. Bona's athletic teams have been known exclusively as the Bonnies since the mid-1990s. That school is one among many hundreds from middle to high school to college that have swapped out their mascots in the last 40 years or so. But a lot has stayed the same, too. No professional team has ever changed its Indian-themed nickname, though the Golden State Warriors did the next best thing by ridding itself of its indigenous imagery. Still, the roll call of pro teams continues to include Cleveland's Indians, Kansas City's Chiefs, Chicago's Blackhawks, Atlanta's Braves, and, as everyone in this room and this region knows very well, Washington's Redskins. This is most egregious of all. The other names in other contexts are not offensive. This one, except when applied to potatoes, always is. But you needn't take my word for it. As Casey Stengel would say, you could look it up. Find it in the dictionary between red shirt and red snapper, and you'll find redskin characterized as disparaging and offensive. The Washington pro football team argues that the name is meant to glorify, not to disparage. The late Jack Kent Cook, when he owned the team, colorfully explained that the name would never change on his watch. He'd say, there's not a single solitary jot, tittle, wit chance in the world that the Redskins will adopt a new nickname. Few will recall that when Cook's estate sold the team, it was originally to be sold to real estate magnate Howard Milstein and his young, lesser-known partner, Daniel Snyder. There was a news conference when Milstein was named provisional owner and a chance for individual reporters to speak to Milstein and Snyder one-on-one for a few minutes. When I got my chance, I asked Milstein about changing the name of the Washington football team, and to my surprise, he said he'd consider it. Snyder sat next to him and didn't say a word, but the look on his face suggested there wasn't a solitary jot, tittle, wit chance that could happen in his world. When Milstein's financing fell through, he withdrew his bid, and Snyder forged a bid of his own that was ultimately accepted. And so here we are. Just a matter of weeks ago, before the Washington pro football team played a postseason game at FedEx Field, one of the local TV stations asked viewers to send in video clips of them and their friends and families singing Hail to the Redskins. Some of them used the original lyrics with some of these since sanitized lines about scalp 'em and wamp 'em, and no one on the air seemed to notice or care. When I began writing about this issue at the Buffalo Courier-Express in the 1970s, I quickly found it makes people very angry. When I interviewed Suzanne Schoen Harjo about this in the 1980s, she said whenever she brings up this topic, she's made to feel like the skunk at a garden party. And in a column for USA Today before the 1995 World Series between the Braves and the Indians, I wrote that people would look back in 50 years and marvel that these names and images survived for so long. That got me an invitation on the old CNN Shoutfest Crossfire, where the late Robert Novak scoffed at the notion that his beloved Chief Alinawek would be gone from the University of Illinois sidelines in 50 years. Turned out it only took 12. Changes come at colleges because they have a moral center and are sensitive to pressure. Neither dynamic applies very well at the pro level. Billionaires are not accustomed to hearing what they don't want to hear or doing what they don't want to do. When the Washington professional football team says that its nickname honors, I'm always reminded of what Humpty Dumpty tells Alice in Through the Looking Glass. When I use a word, Humpty Dumpty says in a rather scornful tone, it means just what I choose it to mean, neither more nor less. To which Alice answers, the question is whether you can make words mean so many different things. Daniel Snyder owns a football team. He doesn't own the dictionary. The word he wants to change the meaning of is a racial epithet. He can't change its meaning any more than he can change its shameful history. Where does that leave the rest of us? Well, we could take Suzanne's advice, be the skunks, make a stink at the garden parties and at the tailgates and the luxury boxes. Mascots are not trivial to me. My father was the one who started the Griffin as the Canisius mascot, and when I went to school there, I was the one who wore the Griffin suit at the arena where I'd gone to those doubleheaders as a child. The cigarette smoke in the rafters was but misty memory, but the brown Indian would remain for 20 more years. And when, at last, he was shown the door, I considered it a victory for Griffins everywhere. A couple of years ago, William and Mary retained the nickname Tribe, but jettisoned all of its indigenous imagery. That meant the nation's second oldest university needed to find a new mascot to patrol the sidelines at its athletic events. Happily, William and Mary came up with a mascot I can readily endorse, a griffin.
Good afternoon. First, I want to just greet everybody who's visiting with us in Washington, D.C., because we are truly a reservation in Washington, D.C., but without sovereignty, so welcome. And we're obviously here to speak about the Washington professional football team that does not reside in Washington. Whole lot of contradictions here. But as I approach this subject, you know, one of the things that that just hits me, it's very interesting to me that if somebody says ouch, that somebody else is going to try to ask them to define how it hurts and how bad it hurts. I grew up believing that when somebody says ouch, they're hurting. It's not up to my interpretation to interpret their hurt, but it is up to that person who has been offended, that person who has been injured. And one should not second guess and play all types of word games and try to dance around the subject and make something that is racist not racist, or make something that disparages somebody not disparaging. The reality is the reality. A person looks you in the eye and say, I'm offended, and therefore we should regard their truth as truth. But we also come back to this. You know what? If you look at the history of this country, people of color have always been put there for the entertainment of white folks. And when people of color could not entertain white folks, they got some imitation people of color to entertain them, like Al Jolson in blackface. Right? The reality is, if you understand what we're talking about, the fact is, Tarzan. I grew up on Tarzan. There's Tarzan, a white man born in Africa, can beat up any African tribe, and even the wildlife is on Tarzan's side and not on the indigenous people's side. Isn't that amazing? Right? But that is the paradigm that folks want us to think in all the time, that somehow people of color are the dominant culture's trophy. It's the dominant culture's collection of an artifact that we are to be defined by somebody else, that we are to be manipulated by somebody else. You know, the reality is all of these things seeks to take away our humanity. And obviously, when we talk about the Washington football team, it is something that continues not only to take away the humanity of Native Americans, but it is also something that offends me, and I'll say this with sitting up here with sports writers, offends me as a person of color about professional sports in this country. Because the reality is that I don't care whether somebody is paid a few million dollars, but the idea of being able to trade another human being or to sell another human being is offensive to me coming out of the history that I come out of. Slavery, even at a high price, is still slavery. Just look at what just happened, in a sense, during the recent football game. Who was that? RG3. Left in the game beyond injury because he was a commodity to be used. Maybe a high-priced commodity, but a commodity just the same to be used for the entertainment of someone else. We got to begin to think about the images, not only that we use, but the language that we use. Because it is a history that we are continuing to reinforce of slavery and annihilation and ethnic cleansing in all the words that we use. And we need to begin to reassess it and begin to change our language system and begin to understand that when folks say ouch, they mean ouch. I was glad to hear Mayor Gray at his State of the District address, where he did not make that reference to that team by that name, but called it the Washington football team, avoiding that. I think that one thing that we need to do is begin to avoid, boycott the word. I start boycotting the word from the pulpit of my church. I will not say it. I will not use it. Because the reality is once we begin to banish the word, maybe people start to get the idea. And we're called to do a full reassessment of how we speak as a people, because how we speak as a people is the way we see the world. Let us change our viewpoint on the world, and let us change our viewpoint on each other.
Why do I have to follow the preacher? Kai's an orator. I don't know what I'm doing up here.
It's worse than that, Mike, because those were two beautifully written pieces before you as well.
I don't have anything in front of me. I'm a sports columnist for the Washington Post. I hosted a radio show in Washington in the last 3.5 years. I am honored to be here, and I can't tell you, and I'd like to some of you to give yourselves a hand. I'd like to say that there's something about being around some like-minded people on this issue. I've always felt like I've been in a vacuum, and to actually see Native people's faces and amongst white, black, Asian, Hispanic, it's very heartening for someone who's thought that he's written a lot of columns that went into wastebaskets for the last 10 years. So thank you for being here. That means a lot. Believe it or not, I came to this issue in many ways because of Eric Brady, another white man. No, I'm kidding. And Eric obviously had a social conscience. I was getting out of school. I actually look older than him now, but he's actually a couple years ahead of me. And I'd read an article in USA Today while I was getting out of school at Fresno State in California. And it was a particularly touching article about this issue. And it mentioned the name of a man named Phil St. John, who was a Minnesota Sioux Indian. And he'd actually had become motivated by this issue when he took his five-year-old to a high school basketball game, and this five-year-old turned away in shame at halftime when a white kid in war paint began doing the woo-woo sound in the child's face. And Phil St. John didn't know what to do with this, and he asked his child what was wrong, and he said, "Daddy, isn't that what we do at powwow?" And he's making fun of us. And he was so moved by his child's reaction and what it did to his self-esteem in that moment that this guy didn't become a militant in the way of you're racist and you need to abolish your name. He went around to 39 high schools in Minnesota and gave thoughtful presentations of how this imagery hurt his kid. And I remember thinking to myself that all 39 of them changed their mascots because of this. And I thought, what if my I have a 2.5-year-old now. What if that was my child and someone was making fun of what I think my ethnicity or who I am as a people mean? I always say I don't have black, white friends. I have friends, some of whom were black, some of whom were white, some of whom were Asian, Hispanic, Hawaiian, Native American. And I always wonder, I always try to put myself in their shoes. Well, what was that your kid? And I've been told on and off again that there are bigger issues in the Native American community that they need to worry about than mascots and images. And I can't help but go back to that moment and that child, because what more contributes to the highest rates of alcoholism and suicide on reservations per capita in this country than a child's self-esteem and who you are and what you believe? And so coming to this issue myself, you're often told, you're a leftist social engineer, or you have white guilt. Like, what is white guilt? I don't feel guilty for what my ancestors did and what they did. I feel that I need to make changes in my own life, and I don't feel that white guilt, to me, there's two other words, human compassion. It's called human compassion. And I don't understand, and I reject the notion that this is an American Indian issue. We're all members of a tribe. It's called the world's tribe. And until we realize that if one person is offended, we should all be offended, we're not gonna move forward anywhere. And I think we need to understand that. I am told roundly every time I write an article about this issue that there are polls done by Sports Illustrated, and the Annenberg Institute at the University of Pennsylvania did a poll that said 9 out of 10 people who identified themselves as American Indians on the telephone out of 770 people in a nationwide poll says that they are not bothered by these images. And then you go back to the Indian Country Today polls and it's exactly the opposite. But either way, I thought, what the heck? I'm gonna do my research. I call up Adam Clymer, who many of you may know as a former reporter at the New York Times and was a head of the Annenberg Institute for a while and directed this poll. And I had worked at the New York Times, where I'd also gotten in touch with this issue some more. They sent me out to the University of Illinois to do a story on Chief Illiniwek. And I said to Adam Clymer, I go, is that right? Is your poll like 9 out of 10? How'd you guys come up with that? And he goes, I don't know what the plus minus percentage of it is. And I don't exactly, I'm not going to say it's 100% accurate. He goes, I'll say this, though. Let's just suppose my poll was right, and 9 out of 10 people contacted that identified themselves as native peoples of this country didn't have a problem with the mascot. And he goes, well, let's take the analogy that you invite 10 people to dinner. You have a big dinner party. And 9 out of the 10 people have the most swell time imaginable. They love the food, the company, the conversation. And one of them you completely offend to the point where the other people are a little uncomfortable. Are you really a social success? No, is the answer. I don't know what this is going to take. I don't know when it's going to happen. But I believe in my lifetime that symbol will disappear from this town. And when it does, there'll be a lot of people to thank, but most of all, the people that were here before us who believed harder and stronger than anybody that it was time that they were identified by who they wanted to be, not who we wanted them to be. Thank you.
At this point, it's going to be difficult to not go about this without restating all the wonderful things that have been said by some very astute people who have been tracking this issue and been the advocates on the front lines for decades, particularly Kevin Gover, Suzanne Harjo, who worked so diligently in pulling this together, and the panelists. It's really an honor to sit here with these folks. This is a part about a community dialogue, and this is sort of like politics. It's a local issue, but it's being played out on a national stage. There are some communities dealing with this issue, and it's interesting how they have resolved some of these problems in reporting it, particularly the Kansas City Star. You may be aware of, does not use the R word in their newspaper reporting about the Washington NFL team. Supposedly, it was named after the, and even so, the Kansas City team, football team, is called the Chiefs. But the origin, as my understanding, was not about natives. It was named in honor of Mayor Harry Bartle at one time. And even that dialogue they had in their community about the name Chiefs, one person wrote in, if the Chiefs are named for a mayor, why don't they have an overweight, middle-aged white guy with glasses on their helmets? There are advocates at every level seeking change about these stereotypes. Louis Risling was on the panel. Some of her relatives were involved in this as well. Because at Hoopa High School changed its mascot from an Indian headdress to an H in 2003. Student council representatives went to Sacramento to support an assembly bill to ban reservation or authorized mascots that were not authorized by reservation-based communities or tribes. But they had Native kids posted at every entrance and sidewalk in Sacramento in the legislature stating, I am not a mascot. That's strong language for kids that age to be sending a message to the legislature where they will hopefully sit someday. And we've got to build that path for them, and they will take it and run with it. This is a community like any other community where you have common bonds. What better common bond can you have than to have a sports team that you want to support wholeheartedly? I'm a sports junkie as well as a news junkie. I like to watch sports of every kind, but I cannot in good conscience support the football team. No one else native in this community can do that too, and many of you, and I appreciate what you're doing by being here and listening and for your efforts in this manner. But we cannot feel a sense of community in that regard. Some people talk about these, the alumni particularly talk about these traditions and modern practices. But those things can change as well. I watched on ESPN, and then I read in the LA newspaper, the Los Angeles Sentinel, which is a community newspaper, about the desegregation of football. In the 20s, there were no black players at colleges and universities. That began to change. I think it was around 1940, Southern Cal had a full black backfield. Even in this area on the East Coast, there was no segregation within the colleges and universities until 1963, when there was a player named Darren Hill who was recruited. He said he didn't want to be like Jackie Robinson, but he was forced into that role, subjected to slurs, taunted, called every name you could imagine. Excellent football player, talented. He couldn't go and play everywhere he wanted to without under death threats. I won't mention the schools in particular, but there were some that they had to escort him every step of the way in and out of the stadium. When he came back home, he could not play in front of his relatives and friends at the home stadium in Maryland. No black people were allowed inside the stadium. But there was a hill where people would gather to watch the football game and watch him, and they cheered when he made some of these great plays. That hill was called, I'll say, Negro Hill, because that's the way it was printed in the newspaper, but you and I know it was something called much different than that. I don't know whether that icon to racism still stands there, but probably not, but certainly it wouldn't be called that in this day and age. So those things can change, and to the benefit, they should change. And Native people would stand beside them to make sure those changes were made. There are supporters, a list of supporters from every imaginable business association that you can imagine, from the NAACP to the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights, Southern Christian Leadership Council, and the Washington Post that's opposed this name since 2006. The Post endorsed that effort. I don't think the people, the owners, understand that they're not honoring us. If they still intend to say that, please take it back. Please, honors like that we don't need. We don't want. Thank you very much.
Well, I want to thank our panelists for, their brevity, their clarity, their passion. I'm a professor. I have to get up and talk all the time. I wouldn't want to go after any of you guys. It's quite wonderful. So the microphone is in the back. People who have questions can go and or comments can go and stand. Sometimes we're going to get a few things via the internet, and I believe our first question falls into that category.
Yes, I want to acknowledge all of the online audience members, and a lot of questions are coming in online internationally. So that's what I'd like to start with. I'd like to actually ask a couple of them at once. A question from Italy, what can people do internationally to support this cause? What can people do locally? What organizations are doing things right now that people can support? So we'll start with that general category of questions.
I don't know. No. I this is one of the frustrations in my existence in following this issue and reporting on it is there's Suzanne Harjo has been as out in front as much as anyone has. I remember attending a meeting in which they many people, like-minded people, wanted to see how they could get this movement going and out there, including little stickers that they gave, love the game, change the name. They had a little Ghostbusters sign across the Redskins' name, and I loved it, and I put it all over. But it was a very small group, and I actually felt like if I asked if she wasn't reporting on it, my boss would find out I was there and excommunicate me. But it's frustrating because I know what you can do. I can't foment a protest myself, but I'll write my butt off if you show up in front of the team's facilities and issue a protest the day before training camp begins. And I'll tell you what, that'll be on national news. And one of the things that people I think don't realize is the people that feel strongly that they want to keep the name, they're not going to have their minds changed. And all the education in the world won't do it. They have to be embarrassed into it. It happens with our political officials all the time. Things have to mean something to somebody, and it has to become politically expedient to get rid of the nickname. And until letters to Roger Goodell, the commissioner of the NFL, Dan Snyder himself, although he's probably thrown a lot away already, are read and people actually embarrass the organization into taking the issue seriously, it's at present moment, the NFL pays the Redskins legal bills against any trademark infringement suits. So therefore, Dan Snyder hasn't spent a penny out of his pocket to defend his nickname. NFL Inc. has. Roger Goodell's lawyers have. And until that changes, it's going to be really hard to get the team to change its nickname.
I'm not sure how much we can do in terms of, you know, going after the sponsors in the same regard. You know, there are sponsors' logos all over the stadium, all over the media that support the team. Now, I think it's like any other campaign. You send messages to them about buying or not using their product. You know, I have a significant belief in those things you learn in basic psychology about spheres of influence, that each one of you has a significant sphere of influence, and you can utilize that, and let's try that.
The resistance to changing the name really has to do with money, and we need to stop buying things that bear that logo. The fact is that with anything that is racist, you need to remind your friends who fall into that bad habit of buying the logo and flaunting it that they need to cease. That if they don't change the name, you basically begin to and make sure you, your friends, your neighborhood withhold the cash that is being poured in terms of the purchase of those items bearing that logo.
Two quick points, actually. If there's a FedEx representative in this audience, I would love for him or her to explain to me why they want to have their name associated with their racist symbol and how that promotes their corporate responsibility policy that's on their website. And two, and second, I challenge Dan Snyder, if he honestly believes this name is honorific, to attend the next meeting of the National Congress of American Indians and use the word Redskins to your face.
Yes, I'd like to thank the National Museum of the American Indian for this very, very important event.
Amen.
I would also like to recognize the online community for tuning in. We have come full circle. We are living now in a time cycle and a season where awareness is rising. I think one strategy, since we're dealing with a sports mentality, strategy and solutions are constantly talked about in locker rooms and on the field. The more we learn about the people that genocide was committed against in this country, the more we will find out the solutions and the strategies to deal with this situation. When we find out what is going on in Peshawar, South Dakota, the heart of everything, Peshla. When we find out what is the Badlands guardian in Canada, we will learn more. I urge everyone in this audience, in the online community, to log in to Peshla and find out what is going on in South Dakota, and to log on the Badlands guardian. I'll conclude by saying this event to me personally is on the level of two other events. One was called Woodstock, where a young man named Jimi Hendrix played an instrumental version of the national anthem and changed consciousness without saying anything. He played a guitar. The other event was an actor by the name of Marlon Brando in front of millions of people at the Academy Award sent Sachin Littlefeather to deny the Academy Award. I'm referencing these events because to me, this event today is on that level because we are in the nation's capital and this is the good news. Feel good when you walk out of here today. We are on our way. Thank you.
I have to admit, sometimes I feel discouraged. 30 years ago, I was playing a drum in front of the stadium when we started protesting this name. Well, that wasn't even the first of it. And we were spit on, and we were cursed by people of all ethnicities, except maybe Native folks, but Latinos who did not know that they were Native. Since then, I've talked to thousands of people, and maybe one in 50 I'll reach. How do we reach these people? I mean, how do we say something so they do get embarrassed, so they do have a conscience? Something about football. I mean, we have this team. Washington goes crazy over it. A few miles away, Baltimore's going crazy over their team. D.C. people say, or D.C. area people, don't have any respect for the Baltimore, et cetera, et cetera. People go crazy over their football team. It's a sports thing. How do we reach through to them? Ms. Baranoff said, you know, we are the nation's capital, and yet we have this disrespect. How do we deal with that? How do we reach out? Anybody?
The Reverend Hagler had it earlier, hit the nail on the head as well as anyone when he said this, it has to be some economic impact. I wrote a column a couple weeks ago essentially saying that Dan Snyder would only listen to one person, that would be Robert Griffin III. And maybe in hindsight, that's a little too much for a 22-year-old to be asked to be taken on, especially one that's undergoing ACL surgery and trying to get back on the field. But he's the one who said, no pressure, no diamonds, not me. And if he really wants to lead, and I understand that there are no Jim Browns or Muhammad Ali's left, and Arthur Ashes and Kurt Floods, that was another day, and those battles were fought and won in many ways. But I reject the notion that this has to be all about economic empowerment, and that has to be the new blueprint for Michael Jordan and Magic Johnson. At some point, you have to have a social conscience and stand for something or fall for everything. And one athlete with the courage and the will to say that, you marched with my relatives in Selma years ago. It's time I march with you now. That has to happen. And if one athlete can hit Dan Snyder in the pocketbook, whether it be a free agent or someone on his roster right now, I believe he will begin to look at the issue differently.
I think, too, that in the media, we have to bring this up. A lot of times it's forgotten about. And we just had the Super Bowl, and every year the commissioner has a news conference, and this is not a question he's ever asked, but my colleague Mike Wise did ask him about this just a few days ago, and his answer was sort of a non-answer. I guess you'd say he punted on that one. He said, no one wants to offend anyone, was about the gist of his remark, but these are the questions that have to keep being asked.
One thing also is not only withhold some of our economic enthusiasm, but clearly in terms of the articles that are written, if they cease to use the name, and get and folks who are making, who are reporting on sports on TV, if they stop mentioning the name, then that eventually gets over to people that it's something that is really incorrect. And again, it's like I said, if somebody says ouch, they mean ouch.
I think one other thing that probably shouldn't be, I don't know how much of an impact it has, and I think time will tell, is that people need to continue to talk about it. There have been more articles about this in the Washington Post in the last couple of weeks than I think I've seen in a very long time. And I know that in a different way, and the sports writers here probably know more about this, and I may know enough to be dangerous, but we may remember that there was a big, big concern in the District of Columbia for many, many years about gun violence and the murder rate. And no one's blaming that on the basketball team. On the other hand, it was disturbing that the name of the basketball team was the Bullets. And the name of the basketball team was changed in large part in response to a concern about what it meant in the community for the name of the team to be the Bullets when all of this was going on. And from what I can tell, the team is doing just fine, if not better, since the, and you would know that better than I
actually,
would.
Actually, the Wizards are still lousy.
Well.
But you would.
But I'm still right.
But you're still right.
But I'm still right. And the point is that community pressure and community recognition of a problem is something that at some point reaches a critical mass that has to be listened to.
There was some discussion earlier today about, you know, using K-12 school systems and presenting these issues to school boards. You as parents, grandparents, you have that opportunity to talk with teachers, educators, principals, superintendents, school boards about these issues. And it can also come in the context of something we deal with every year. Let's say Thanksgiving, for instance. You see kids running around with the same regalia or faux regalia as you do with the Washington football team. It's not right. It's derogatory, but how much of a big deal do we make it? You know, because the kids are trying to do something to mimic and do something complimentary, and I give them more credit than I would someone who's an adult who's jumping up and down like a fool out in the middle of a stadium. So, you know, but that's still an opportunity and still a place to make those points known.
I'm an actual native of D.C. I was actually born in the hospital a few miles from where the team plays, you know. But I drew my first breaths in just off Bladensburg Road in D.C. So I've grown up with, but I'm not a sports fan. So I grew up with the team, and I didn't care about them. But I guess I've been energized recently by, you know, just you know, being more aware. I have my consciousness raised, you know, about this particular issue only recently, and I've been, you know, my part in it is being a nerd. I've been editing the Wikipedia articles on the subject, and so I've been reading all this information. And what I can understand, I became aware of the 2001 Civil Rights Commission opinion and all this body of knowledge that says this is a civil rights violation. So I don't understand why all of these public and private policies against discrimination just automatically kick in and disallow saying Redskins in a public place. You know, how can the Washington Post print that word? How can a radio station say that word or a TV station say that word?
Well, you know, partly is because we have not made it culturally unacceptable. And that's what I'm getting at, because I grew up not too far from here in Baltimore, and I remember how people used to call in on the radio shows, and they would use the N-word, and it would go out over the air, because it was an acceptable thing to do in a place like Baltimore when I was growing up, until we made it unacceptable. And the reality is that's what we need to continue to push towards, is to make it unacceptable, because as long as folks sort of wink and blink and give it permission to exist, it will continue to exist. As long as we, and when we get to that place where we start chastising our friends, our relatives, and our neighbors for using that word, making it unacceptable, that's when things will change.
I don't know if everybody remembers Do the Right Thing, but there was a great, in Spike Lee's movie about 25 years ago, there was a really telling scene in which each ethnicity in the movie made fun of other ethnicities. And the Korean man made fun of the Italians and the blacks, and the blacks made fun of the Italians and the Korean man in the most despicable, worst slur ways imaginable. And when they did the audience screening, they said that everybody laughed their butts off until their ethnicity came up. And the moral of that story to me is, you know, I'd love to see somebody depicted their own race in that way. I know Daniel Snyder would probably be upset by a team named the Hebrews and a mascot named Ira with the Dead Sea Scrolls in one hand and the Torah in the other. Probably be very angry.
My question is a follow-up to the one before, but I want to ask it a little differently. I teach Native American politics, and we end up discussing this in class every term. Mr. Weiss, we read your articles in class. My classes visit this museum. Mr. Holden, you remember us a couple of months ago coming to NCAI. And so in politics, we're thinking of cause and effect. And it reminds me, the Baltimore was brought up a moment ago, that 20 years ago the NFL forced a team in Baltimore that was playing in a different league to stop using a name, the Colts. And that maybe the impetus has to come from the league. So in looking at cause and effect, what would create that action by the league? And Mr. Holden, you mentioned that there was a newspaper in Kansas City that refuses to use the name. And so along the lines of the question that was just asked, Mr. Wise, how close is the Washington Post to not using the name? Because if the hometown paper did that, I believe that would spread to print and then television media, and eventually the league would notice. Right.
How about USA Today first? No, I don't want to punt on the issue, because I took it up with my own editors when I, it's funny, if they had known that they hired a sports writer that couldn't stand the team's nickname, I wonder if I would have got the job in hindsight. But I stopped using the name for about a year after I first got to Washington. I think it was 2005. And what happened in my case, I believe a newspaper-wide boycott would be different, but was that almost the story became about me more than it did the issue. And I would get all these nasty emails, and you're trying to spite us. And it was clear, it's kind of hard to write around the nickname when you're writing a story about the team. But you know, I did it for a year, and I enjoyed it. In fact, I loved it, because people sent me angry emails, and it made people think. But it really, I did feel like it became about me. We have a new editor. His name's Marty Baron. We will be meeting with him as a sports department tomorrow. I will bring this issue up, I assure you.
Hello. I'd like to comment on a couple of things that was said today. One was, like, why would an Indian school have an Indian insignia, or whatever they call those mascots? I'm from Red Lake, Minnesota, and we have the Warriors. But it's not in this type of thing here where you're making fun of somebody, and you have crowds of people dressed as Indians hollering and laughing and having a good time. That's one reason I don't go to a Redskins game, because I'll be in jail for assault in 10 minutes, you know. But in Red Lake, Warriors to us, the Okeechee Dog, they call it, is the word for it. Warriors in our culture means a guy who takes care of his family, teaches his kids, loves his wife, does all that stuff, and protects his family in against anything that's going to harm him. And that's the symbol that the kids at Red Lake High School are honoring when they play their games and when they go to school. That's what warrior means to them. During the game, they sing their Ojibwe song, and that's it. You don't see kids or anybody else parading around in Indian outfits or anything like that, because we do it in respect. We don't do it to mop the ground with American Indians the way that stadium full of whoever's out there in Washington or in Landover do. We don't do it that way. And another thing was, I also had an incident in Minneapolis. It was an Orono Indians against Cooper Hawks, I think it was. And I lasted about 10 minutes in there with my two kids, because that's what they were doing. And my kid said the same thing. He said, "Dad, they're making fun of us." I told him, "Let's get out," and we went. You know, and but they a lot of them have changed their names. And one other guy here talked about evil before, and I think that has a lot to do with it, the evil and the hatred. And I believe that it comes through from history. My mother was born in 1914. A lifetime today is like 80 years old. And it would have been the time when, you know, 1914, put another 80 before that, you know, and the Indian Wars were going on in like 2.5 lifetimes ago. And people still have that in them, you know, it's still in them. I've lived in Red Lake and I grew up there. People up there still have that thing of, we want to beat up Indians, we want to hunt for Indians, times has stood still around there a lot when you go into the towns out of Red Lake. And, you know, and so this, I don't have as much hope about this thing changing as other people do, because, like I said, it's been like 2.5 lifetimes since the wars were on. Everybody still, at least where I come from, still feel that. And if there's one thing that will change Daniel Snyder, I think is the money thing. But I am hopeful. You know, I felt this way before Barack Obama was elected. I thought, it's not going to happen. You know, it just isn't. And I hope when I was wrong there that I'm wrong here too.
All right.
Thank you. Anybody want to respond?
Yeah, hi. I wanted to bring up the fact that you would give us such great support if we could show up at the next pre-practice, or when they start practicing again. And back in the early 90s, I had made a promise in the NIPI that I would protest for 4 years, and I did. And it was easy to protest at RFK. Everybody was pouring out of the metro into the stadium, and you could just hit them with all your flyers and your statements. Anyway, then they, you know, Cook, he built a protest-proof stadium. I mean, you can't do it. I tried once, the first Dallas game, I went there, and, you know, it cost $8 to get into the place, you know, and then you can't carry anything with you. You can't carry anything but sneak in maybe some paper. And then you're in this massive crowd that, like, there's no organization to, and then, you know, the band goes by, and then you have to leave because the game's ready to start. And you have to wait about an hour and a half to kind of get out of there because there's no more buses going back to the parking lot. So it's a protest-proof building. And now they've moved to Richmond, so we can't even go to Virginia to like do a little, hit them. Do you have any suggestions other than just, you know? And I have to say, I guess it was just you in the Post that promised that they wouldn't use the name, because I thought it had been the Post that had made that promise at one time.
I'm one of about three columnists now that have taken positions. Bob McCartney, Robert McCarthy took one today in Metro. Courtland Malloy has been a longtime advocate of abolishing the nickname. Yeah. And the Post actually had an editorial, I believe Robert Holden said, in 2006 was the last one that said, as an editorial on the editorial page, as a paper we don't like, that we agree that the name is inappropriate, but the paper has never, as such, decided to actually abolish the nickname. And as far as the, it's a utopian thing in many ways to get the media on many levels to disregard the name. But for instance, there's networks in this town, two or three that I can think of, that have deals, broadcast deals with the team, very lucrative deals. And for them to do that, it would be saying goodbye to the majority of their broadcasting revenue and it'd be a hell of a courageous move. I don't know if it's realistic. I think that it's going to be more of a grassroots thing. Richmond is a training camp. It's only a couple weeks. They'll be in Ashburn, Virginia most days. I got to think that there's got to be some place if someone wanted to organize a protest in Prince George's County.
Too bad they're not still at Carlisle. That was the perfect place.
Was that? Carlisle would have been apropos.
Yeah. And, you know, if you could just ask your colleague, Mr. Boswell, he used the name 18 times in one article last fall. And it was, like, overwhelming. I mean, maybe they could at least tone it down, even if they can't give it up.
I'm going to beat him with a rubber hose. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
I had an experience with a reporter like that earlier, but nevertheless. But there are still, we have to use any and all strategies. I mean, that still doesn't preclude you from writing letters to the editor of the Post. They still receive those, and sometimes they get printed. Most of the time they don't, but nevertheless, that's one way. You know, there's two news, all news stations, radio stations in this town. There used to be just one. The one that's been here the longest, I used to listen to them and still did until there was a couple of weeks ago or maybe about a month ago where they said something to the effect that, why is everyone making a big deal about changing the name? It doesn't need to change, and they should just forget about it. So now I go to the newer station, news station. So there's things that you can show in terms of your support or non-support of some of these stations.
You know, the name becomes so much a part of the fabric of the community. My kids are grown now, but when my son was in first grade, the Redskins played the Buffalo Bills in the Super Bowl, and he came home from school all wide-eyed and said, the principal says everybody has to wear Redskins stuff tomorrow. So I sent him to school in Buffalo Bills gear, and let me just say that's character building for a first grader.
Yeah, I don't know what to do. I have a 2.5-year-old, and he's running around the house going, RG3, RG3. And my wife and I already discussed it. I said, no skin stuff in the house. I don't want to see any of the paraphernalia. If he wants to like the team at some point, that's fine, but I'm not going to have any stuff in the house. Except my press pass.
Uh-huh. I've been here all day. I listened to the other panels as well, and I wanted to ask a question early. I just couldn't get enough time to do it. But it occurs to me that the first step in solving any problem, of course, is to define it accurately. And my sense of it is that we're talking more about symptoms than we are disease, and that the issue with the Washington football team, I'm a native Washingtonian, it's hard for me to say that. The Washington football team is simply symptomatic of a larger issue, if not dealt with, will persist. You know? And I think that issue within which all of this has to be defined is white supremacy. We would be in this position if that weren't the dominant, overriding, and most influential issue since the beginning of this nation. And it is singularly responsible, though we participate and enable it on occasion, for all of the things that we're talking about now. And yet, in these kind of meetings, rarely is it pointedly brought up as a question to be dealt with? And I'm waiting to go to a conference that is titled something like, how do we define white supremacy and who believes in it?
Wow.
Yeah, you got it. I was telling you so.
I don't know if I want to be seen at that conference.
I'll just say, you know, that's a serious part, because that's what this is about. I mean, it's the whole idea of how you use and utilize people of color. Let me put it that way. Because it is a framework that says that there is a group that's in charge, and there's another group that is to be exploited, used for entertainment, used for work, used for everything else. But it's a group that exists, and that's where you want to put them at. I was saying to somebody earlier, you know, when we all talk about an image, this was years ago when I was in Mozambique, and it was Frelimo had just basically came to power. And in the biggest cathedral in Maputo, they had an altar set up, and on that altar, on the wall, was this fresco. And it was of a Portuguese knight with a Portuguese ship sitting out in the harbor with that Portuguese flag on it. And the knight was all armored up, had a sword, had a Portuguese flag in this hand. And when you look down, he had his foot on the side of the face of a black man in the dirt. Mm. It's the images that continue to reinforce that kind of superiority, that kind of disregard that you have for somebody else. And so that's what this is really about, overcoming.
At the risk of causing some dissension, I agree with that, and let me be clear about that. But I think it's a much more nuanced, complicated issue here, because to put it, you know, Washington, D.C. had been, I'm not sure it is anymore because the demographics are changing, but Washington, D.C. had been a majority African-American city, and that may be changing because of because there's a larger Latino population as well. But I think that part of why this is such a difficult issue is because, let's face it, a lot of the most supportive fans of the local football team are African-Americans, Latinos, members of other minority groups as well. And part of the issue is that, and I think there was a column recently that Cortland Malloy wrote about the name of a mountain in that's called Mount Negro, and why Native American Indians and Native Americans should be supportive of changing that name for the same reason that African Americans should support changing the name of the local football team. I think it's much more complicated, because that whole point that was made in the earlier panel about how people don't appreciate that this is a slur until somebody says, how would you feel if this team was called by whatever it is that's an offensive derogatory term to whoever you are? And everybody has some derogatory term about them. I think that's why this is so insidious and so difficult, because it isn't just about Native Americans. It's about everybody. And it's the way we're all treating each other, and that's why it's such a, I think, a difficult and a really insidious problem for the community.
One great point. One of the toughest things, or one of the most interesting dichotomies to me is, if many of you are familiar with Chief Z, Zema Williams, who I've met on occasion and is the nicest, most genteel man you'll ever meet in your life, and he goes out and does charity events for children, all while as an African American man dressed up in headdress and feathers, and I had a hard time reconciling with, well, what is this man doing wrong, until I saw a documentary by Charlene Teeters, who helped get, who was a graduate student in Illinois when she protested Chief Olainowak. She came out with a documentary called In Whose Honor, And she has, in 1991, she has an encounter with Chief Z in front at RFK, in which she tells him, these are my people, how can you dress up like this? And he says, I ain't got nothing against your kin. I ain't got nothing. And she says back something to him, and he doesn't know what to respond. And he finally walks away. He's embarrassed. And she starts crying. And it's the most powerful, moving thing you've ever seen in your life, a Native American woman, an African American man. And I thought to myself, what if she was dressed up like him? What if she had dressed up like a Zulu warrior? And the head and on the side of the helmet was Dan Snyder said he was honoring the warrior spirit of the African people, and I don't think Zema Williams would dress up like that. I don't.
What I get worried about is that, you know, that we're sort of dancing a little bit. And when I say we're dancing a little bit, it's because there is the issue of consumer versus the issue of owner. Right? And all the time, people are seduced into this consumer status. Particularly, that's how you keep people who are oppressed oppressed, is that they feel good because they're able to participate at a lesser level and make somebody at the top a whole lot of money. For example, you know, black folks should not be going to Walmart, for example. Right, because of the way Walmart produces its products and what Walmart does in terms of voter suppression. But we do. Until we basically begin to deconstruct what is going on and therefore come up with new understanding of what our participation in that really results in. But, you know, but the fact is that the fan is not Dan Snyder, right? Dan Snyder is the one that's going to the bank, right? We're going to the bank machine to get the money for the ticket and the paraphernalia. So we got to begin to change that paradigm, right? And take the money out of Dan Snyder's pocket and keep it in ours.
These people are very smart in that regard. For instance, they would a company would sell paraphernalia of the Ravens and then the other NFL team in this area. And I went to a corporate meeting and had a discussion with some of the top-tier executives about this and brought it up that they will sell that here in D.C., but they wouldn't dare go out to South Dakota or Oklahoma and sell the same things where you have a significant Native American community. But nevertheless, it's the same company with the same money going to the top.
Hello. Obviously, that the term that we've been talking about, the R word, is obviously has a very negative connotation. I wanted to suggest the idea of the petition on the White House. I think that they require 100,000 signatures, and if we can get people to sign up to perhaps change the football team's name, we might be able to get a lot more national attention. And the White House has to respond if we get 100,000 people.
Great idea. And I can't personally sign you up as you leave the building, but someone could possibly give you a sheet.
I mean, even easier than that, right, is sign on, rather than, I mean, so the White House, sure, but I'm not sure that the president's going to necessarily take up this issue, but sign on, right, has a much lower threshold for sending that out, and I just actually was interested in saying the same thing. And I Google searched, and there's one petition already up that suggests that they changed the team name to the Piscataway. It's only got 30 signatures, so no worries. But if we launch one right now, you know, you can start to put those kinds of numbers together. And I don't know, if Mr. Wise, if you really are interested in bringing this to your department meeting tomorrow, but I suspect we could get a couple hundred signatures right now, and you could click on the page and show it tomorrow.
I would do that, and it would probably bring my argument a little more weight, so thank you.
So if you want to Google that, it'll be up momentarily. Yeah.
What did he say?
It'll be up momentarily.
Momentarily, all right.
Hello? Oh, okay.
How you doing? My name is Andre Holland. I'm a student at AACC. I've come here with my professor. He put us on this field trip where I did not know where I was really going. but I'm like, I'm in college. Why am I going on a field trip? But basically, I want to say that I think it's really ignorant that the fact that us as humans are keeping the name Washington Redskins. Like, first of all, when I walked in here, everybody was staring at me with my cap on. I was like, okay, why is... Like, I thought this was something good. Like, I was like, okay, that's why I wore my Washington Redskins hat. But this Native American man right here, came to me and said, can you take off your hat? You know, I'm, you know, offended. I was like, wow. And at first, I was keeping it on, but it made me think, like, how would it feel if they were called the Washington, excuse my language, Washington niggers? I would be offended. I'm sure other people would be offended, too. So I really think that they should really change the name, because a few hours ago, I was listening to the first conference meeting down here, on the screen upstairs, and I was tweeting. I found you can hashtag. I was, you know, basically in a different state of mind saying, I don't get it. Why can't we have, you know, the Washington logo? It doesn't mean anything. I had, like, at least 10 Native Americans come out of nowhere and start talking to me. I was like, what is this? I was like, I'm ready to delete my account. But basically, they were basically telling me that this is ridiculous and what it truly meant to, you know, the name Washington Redskins and how they got it. And I was like, wow, like, I'm just now knowing this. So why can't they just change the name to Washington Warriors? I found out, I actually asked one of them that question. They said, well, actually, Warriors is good because it meant that, you know, it was actually a job. Like, you know, there was certain things they had to do. So would it be bad if they just changed the name to Washington Warriors?
That's a good question, because I've heard that before, too. I think if you deleted all the Indian imagery, and, you know, I always thought this would be win-win for Dan Snyder. You dedicate the new name to the Wounded Warriors, and you have either a veteran or someone on the helmet that is not an Indian, and you retire the old nickname honorably, you'd have the old merchandise and memorabilia going like crazy on eBay, and you know, the Tennessee Titans weren't in existence. 3 years later, they were the fourth hottest selling jersey in the league because it was new. There were new colors. I say keep the colors, call them Warriors. Now, I think there might be an issue of, do you really want to name somebody after the military of the United States government, which essentially tried to commit genocide on the American Indian? I mean, it's a really difficult issue. It's a really difficult issue. Like, how do you get around to coming up with the right new name?
So, well, first of all,
But the big thing is abolish the one that's there first.
Yeah, well, first of all, I just want to apologize to any Native American, because I'm not a racist. I know I'm not a racist. So the fact that, like, I had to wear that hat and take it off, like, it makes me think. Like, I actually have friends that are Native American, and now I know why they were staring at me one day. They never told me, but every time I came in on my Redskin stuff, they were always staring at me. And every time I said bye to the parents, they would look at me like, don't talk to me. I'm like, oh. So, but I really think they should change the name, and I think it's really horrible that they decided to keep this name.
I'd just like to say that I was a little worried today that we were preaching to the choir, but we do have one convert. So that's a good thing.
First of all, to kind of follow up on that, as a retired teacher, we just all witnessed the power of education. One mind changed one time, he changes someone else. I suppose I should direct my question to Daniel Snyder, but interesting enough, there's been a lot of people in and out today, and he hasn't been there, nor anyone from the organization. So I'm gonna direct it to the panel, even though I'm asking you to get inside of a mind. If we talk about economics, and Mr. Wise, you just addressed that, if they were to change, that economic picture for Daniel Snyder gets a lot bigger. New logo, new uniforms, the whole thing. A few fans get upset, 12 cancel their tickets, and 1,000 in line to get them. So based, if I'm correct in my thinking, what is it? Is it what, you know, Reverend Hagler said, some kind of oppression, or I'm so big, or just the billionaire syndrome, I can do what I want? I'm just kind of at a loss to fathom
And again, it's an unfair question. You're going inside someone's mind. Why doesn't he send a representative today? He comes today. I mean, that might not be the place. But why not change the name if you're Daniel Snyder? I think I would at least look at it, even if I only cared about the economic end of it. Any ideas?
Because billionaires don't like to be told what to do. Right. Yeah. And I think, and not only did he says he had a Ronnie Ridskin belt buckle when he was a child, and that was sort of a big deal to him, but I also think, I think that that name is, name does mean something to him, but I also think that there, the previous panel talked about these identities that people take on, and if you have to give that up, it means that you were a bad person for holding it near to your heart to begin with, and he can't admit that. And I think even more than that, he thinks this is PC, and anything that's PC is wrong, and the idea that there's backlash against it should be right, and you shouldn't change something just because people are offended by it. Everybody's offended by everything. Well, guess what? This is political, and it's correct.
You know, I've listened to all of this, and I can tell you this, that you will never hear that word on WPFW, the station that I broadcast on. And I see, Eric, I see you looking at me. I'm the guy that you were on the radio with last Friday. You know, I feel very deep down inside that maybe we've missed it. It's called stubbornness and arrogance. And I've heard so many people talk about white privilege, white guilt. I don't think it's really about that. I think it's about the almighty dollar. And I think it's about a man that under no circumstances will he eat crow. And, you know, Reverend Hagler, you were so correct in your analogy of how one group of people have to dominate everybody else in their minds. But I think we need to take this to a spiritual level, because all of the fighting and infighting and name calling and all the games that people play because they don't like something that somebody does or somebody says, I think if we take it to a higher level, or spiritual level, because it's what's inside you that really means more than anything else. And I'll tell you this. My grandfather used to always say something. It was actually my great-grandfather. And he spoke broken Cherokee, broken English, and a little Choctaw. But I'm going to put it to you the way he used to say it. It's not about the pigmentation of my skin, or the color of my eye, or the texture of my hair, or the clothes I wear. It's not about my culture or my tradition or who I call my God. Does anybody in here know what it's really all about? Can one person raise their hand and tell me what it's really all about? It's all about how you treat my heart. That's what it's all about.
My name is John, and I'm often very, very lonely, especially around football time. I'm an ex-football player, a football coach that's been humiliated personally and had my own son personally humiliated. I'd like to thank Mr. Weiss. I did call in a few years ago to relate the story about my son's experience, and I felt less lonely that day. I feel less lonely this day. I've given 33 years of my life to this country in uniform, and I often feel lonely. And I often feel that my Indian heritage feels owned by others. I think that what this is about is ownership. We own you, is what I've heard people say about my native heritage. Don't you understand? We can't do what we used to do to the black African American people. The Latinos now have political power, but we own you. We will define how we honor you. Don't tell us how to honor you, because we own you. If we want to call you Redskins in the nation's capital, we will, because we own you. If we want a nickname or have our code name Osama bin Laden and call him the name that my son's named after, Geronimo, we will do that, and we own you. We won't call him Martin Luther King or Cesar Chavez, but we will call Osama bin Laden Geronimo because we own you. That's what this is about. We can talk about the economics. The team from Washington would make more money if they changed, and they all know it. They wouldn't lose sponsorship. They'd still have 70,000 people go to the games. It's not about money. It's about the last group that the dominant culture feels that they own lock, stock, and barrel, and they can get away with it. When I was honored to be the director of the American Indian Education Commission in Los Angeles, I naively thought through education the schools would change, and after death threats and 17 years, they finally did. But it was only after we videotaped what Joe Brave really was doing. And as a person got up and said, we do nothing but honor you, we put it up in a screen behind that person. And they were embarrassed enough to say, wow, if that's what's going on, I guess we're not honoring you. Thank everyone for being here. I appreciate being less lonely today. Thank Mayor Vincent Gray for standing up, which isn't to his political or economic advantage, but it absolutely is the right thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I might add a thank you again to Suzanne Harjo, who for years has been called by NFL Inc. In legal papers a militant. Well, the only militant thing about her is her father was a code talker during World War II and still has had shrapnel in his leg till the day he died from a wound suffered in the World War in Italy, in the Second World War. And so this is a woman whose father served honorably in the military and is doing more for all of us in here than anybody can imagine. So thank you, Suzanne.
My name is Amparo, and I'm from South America. This debate was really, really great and very informative, and I just want to share some thoughts. I don't understand too much about football, but I do understand about racism and prejudice, and especially via education. And this is sort of like educational. I want to share that when I was growing up and as a teacher myself, I was learning all the time how history is written by the winners. And for instance, in South America, we always learn that when the Europeans come to America, immediately the Native American cultures, like the Incas, which I partially am, we immediately worship them because they have white beards and white hair, and we look at them so amazingly figures. But that's not true, totally. That's absolutely not true. So I just want to share these things because I think it all about these stereotypes is about power. It's about put the other person, the others down. And it's a hidden agenda, and it's let our evil side in our surface. That's all I want to say. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank this panel and the other panels for really encouraging our hearts and minds. I feel that this question is almost somewhat anticlimactic, but do any of the panelists know what the present state of the Washington football team supporting NRA-sponsored shooting events? And some of those events, if I'm not mistaken, were geared toward youth, and this has happened over the last few years. I don't know if the team has stopped their involvement with that or not, but I'd like to know if any of the panelists do know.
Got to call my editors. That's a good story.
I didn't know anything about that.
Never heard of it. I didn't.
I spent about 40 years in the sports and entertainment business.
And Mr. Holden, it was a beautiful thing when I witnessed you being interviewed out here after the last session by Channel 4. And the gentleman, even though you expressed to him that you found the R word offensive, he continued to say it right to your face over and over again with the disguise that he was going to get the best sound bites, go back to the studio and edit it. I can't wait to see what that edit looks like. Congratulations to you, sir, for holding in there. But here's what I'm really here for. In my sports, let's call it career, I've had the opportunity to work for some NFL teams. My last venture was with Mr. Kraft up in New England when he recruited me away from the Meadowlands in Jersey. Jimmy Hoffa's there, you know. Anyway, he sat me down and he said, here's your first assignment. Run some numbers, see what the effect of a logo change will do for us. Ran the numbers, presented it to him, case closed. The big obstacle, of course, is, as you, Mr. Wise, pointed out, the NFL owns a lot of the logos. It's not the individual teams. So that's where you really have to start. And you know why they're hesitant to make changes? Because the reality is they're worried about taking the violence out of the sport today. They're hesitant on concussions. They're hesitant on sports injuries. Someone else said it earlier, RG3, they threw him like a gladiator. Let's not forget it's a gladiator setting that we're involved in here with the NFL. Because they're afraid of the violence being diminished, they're going to hold on to images that support violent thinking, just like our television shows, just like our movies. The NFL is basically all about violence.
I think you make a great point about Dan Snyder probably is a bad target at this point. That the target has to go beyond that, and the target is probably Roger Goodell and the NFL.
With all due respect, Reverend Hagler, I'm going to push back a little bit on your last statement. You make a comment that I think the lion's share of blame, I guess, goes to Dan Snyder, and I would say that that's not true. I would say that there's definitely personal responsibility in this. And if people say at this point, this late in the game, after 30-some years, after this many people knowing about it, after Native people protesting, if they can say that they don't get it, that is absolutely willful ignorance, and they are working very, very hard to remain ignorant about it. So there is absolutely personal responsibility here. Dan Snyder is not there in people's bedrooms every morning when they choose to take that Redskins hat off and put it on, wear it to work, or wear it out on the streets. So I just want to make sure that I say that. And I'll share a perspective. I've been in D.C. for about 3 years. And so this is the first time that I've been accosted with this stuff on a daily basis. I mean, literally multiple times a day. Sure. I'm at work. I work at a federal agency, and I am literally accosted with this stuff. I'm also an attorney. I work with civil rights attorneys. We talk about this stuff. They can go through the legal analysis of what a disparaging work environment is. They know it inside and out. They see it for other people, but they are complicit with it. And so if I cannot get other civil rights attorneys who understand this stuff to care about it, who can I get to care about it? And so what this whole thing has taught me is that most people are just really, I don't want to say morally lazy, but they're just not willing to take on a fight. They're just not. They see it, but they're just not willing to do it at all.
Let me come back at you just for a second, because yes, I agree. It is personal responsibility. But it goes deeper than that. It's personal awareness. We must choose to be aware. Things are set up, and the paradigm is set up in the culture, where we are drugged by more things than just drugs. We really don't look at the effect of things as they affect our neighbors and our neighborhood and other people who live across town and around. We don't think of it. In fact, there was serious pushback when I raised up the issue about folks going to see the team, folks wearing logos. In my congregation, there was pushback. Most of the folks I discovered had never even thought of it. Because one thing that happens in even a place like D.C., we think D.C. is cosmopolitan. We think. But what you discover, and I've been many, many places, people really don't know one another in D.C. And so they don't really don't know somebody's hurt, somebody's pain. They don't know somebody's struggle. This is a place where it's almost like, in some ways, a series of country towns. And it's amazing what people don't know. And it's amazing what people never have thought about. And it's amazing, even with stuff being debates out there and discussions out there, what people have never even encountered. And that's our job, is to make folks encounter it. Make folks change. Make folks think about it. Make folks come to a place where they go, the light goes on, and they say, aha, now I think I understand. After last couple, about 4 weeks ago, church member that I have an ongoing argument with about that, finally went out in the church's parking lot after service and ripped that flag off her car. Finally. But again, you know, I'm saying, yes, it's personal responsibility, but our job, and particularly my job as a preacher, as an organizer, is to try to wake people up to see and to hear. Because people's ears are really stopped up because they're really satisfied with being consumers. If you can buy the things, you feel good and you don't need to think about anything else. And we got to begin to create for people the dynamic where people have to look at the relationship of what they're contributing to in a very non-thinking way and liberate them so that they can engage in the liberation of their sisters and brothers.
I hear what you're saying, but again, I guess I'll say that if people don't get this at this point, they are making a decision to not get it. They just are.
I hear that loud and clear, but I'll come back to this place because the fact is that we live, in a sense, within our own communities and within our own debates. And we discover it all the time. And the issue is how do we break out the debate in a larger way? Because one of the things we really find out is that, I'll give you an example. I still struggle with black folks using the N-word on themselves. Don't understand that is so used to using it, it just rolls off the tongue without second thought. That's what goes on inside the community. And folks who are inside the community know I'm accurate in that. And so it's a part of getting people, waking up folks, because what exists around us is a media culture and a consumer culture that dumbs people down and deliberately dumbs people down.
And having taken a lot of phone calls over the year on my radio show that I did for 3.5 years, that topic, the nickname topic, always took up all of my hours, and it was great because we'd have some all-time fights. But I get what you're saying. Some people wanted to hear what they wanted to hear, and they would not give an inch to the idea of being educated. So that, to me, told me there's going to be a fight, and who's on this side and who's on that side of this issue. And it's going to come, and it's going to come soon.
I think that the other part of that equation in terms of personal responsibility is that once you're aware is what do you do with that? You know, it's not just, well, maybe I stop buying or maybe I stop watching or something of that nature. But also, what do I do? I'll take that to the next step. Personal responsibility to tell other people, to tell your neighbor that we've talked about here today, to write that letter, to do the things that are going to make that change in the greater, that's sort of personal responsibility as well. And I think many of you have done that and I appreciate that.
Hi, I'm Hello. Ebony Ellis. I'm a DC student. I go to Wilson High School and my school was here on a field trip. I'm here with my history teacher. So we're learning about, you know, the Trail of Tears and stuff of that sort with the Native people. And I just wanted to make a comment on, like, this is a perfect time for awareness. I have lots of friends and families that are huge fans of the team. My family and I personally aren't from the DC area, so we don't really support the Washington football team. But I think the biggest target at this point, it should really be the youth, because at a point they are the biggest supporters of sports. They're crazy about football. And like my friend over there just posted a picture on Instagram, like I'm at a debate about whether, excuse my language, the Redskins should keep their name or not. And it's about 10 comments going, no, they shouldn't. They should never change it. Like, I'm interested in this type of stuff, but I think if discussions like this go out into our communities and schools and like enlighten our youth about it, I mean, they're the future. We can bury this name now so it doesn't reach out 20, 30 years from now and still being used. Like, Dan Snyder, all these people are gonna soon be gone. The name can be gone and we can start over. So that's my comment.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I want to thank the panel for your comments. I've learned an awful lot this afternoon and this morning as well. And of course, I want to thank Suzanne Harjo and the museum for this forum. I think it's been excellent, and I hope that it keeps the ball rolling. I just wanted to, I come from the perspective of a long-term Indian educator, 40 plus years, and I've seen a lot of different things, from a classroom teacher to an athletic coach to a principal to a tribal college president. And I don't know if I heard Mr. Holder right, but I heard him say a couple times this is a local issue. I don't know if I necessarily agree with that, but simply because of where this team plays and what it represents in the city. But I think there's one ingredient that I haven't heard today at all, and that is, where are our tribal governments? I think if we're gonna say ouch, we need a bigger ouch. We need 500 sovereign nations talking about this issue.
I didn't mean for that to sound like it's a purely local issue, but certainly, you know, my point also was that it was played out on the national stage. So it is, you know, getting coverage, and there's people all over the country that have vested interest in this. But also in terms of response from tribal governments or support of tribal governments, the National Congress of American Indians passed a resolution in 2005 against mascots and logos, and we have cultural committees that deal with us on the regular basis. So we do address this within our education committees.
And to Reverend Hagler's point earlier, I'd be remiss if I didn't say there is something to do with white supremacy in here. You can't make up what we've heard today. Earlier in the symposium, Lone Star Dietz, the team's first coach, was discredited to be a fake Indian. He was the person that was originally named for the team. George Preston Marshall named the team for him. He assumed another Indian's identity. George Preston Marshall was a known segregationist who refused to integrate his team until 1961. 1961, he waited. And why? Because of business. Because the Redskins, pardon my term, were the team of the South. And when the Atlanta Falcons and the Carolina Panthers had no franchises, they had the radio rights locked up in the South. So the team of the South became the Skins. To this day, I'll go to cover a game in Atlanta, in Tampa, in Carolina, and half the stadium will be burgundy and gold because that's the team they grew up loving. And that team was supported by an owner who, when he died, left millions of dollars to a school only on the condition that they remain segregated. This is the team that has this nickname. Symbolism is so important in this country, and when they opened this museum, They had thousands of American Indians marching a certain way, toward the same way the Trail of Tears went. And in this town, that symbol and this name still stands. You can't make this up.
Something the young woman who's an attorney mentioned made me think of the NFL's policy regarding personal responsibility. So I looked it up, and it says it's important that the NFL be represented consistently by outstanding people as well as great football players, coaches, and staff. We hold ourselves to higher standards of responsible conduct because of what it means to be part of the National Football League. So I just wonder, do you think that in the various ways that people have talked about kind of bringing attention to this issue, that this would be one way that you could get the NFL's attention to the fact that they're not holding themselves to a higher standard of conduct?
I didn't know I was next, so. Well, basically, my name is Andrew. I'm from the Umsalaga Nation in Montana, and I noticed when we talk about Native Americans, we talk about them in one singular way. We say Native Americans, we say American Indians and Redskins. That doesn't even come close to naming all the different tribal names as they were really known. We're known as the Crow by a lot of people because of a way of just looping the Crow tribe of our different clans into one name, so it's easy to call us, just like the Sioux. There's a lot of different bands of Sioux that were looped into one name that makes it easy for white people to say and explain and keep together. A lot of people don't know that the name Sioux actually means just snake, just a little person who's not to be trusted and down below you. I think the Redskins remain the same way. It takes all the tribal names into one way of calling Indians, and it's very easy to keep going in society because people I know in the military go in and they're called by their tribal names. People in the Blackfeet are called Pikuni. People who are Crow who are in the military are called Absalaga because in the military, they understand the sacrifices Indians have made all through the military for their country. I just wonder why the moment they leave the military and come to Washington, D.C., people seem to forget all the sacrifices Indians have made for this country and just call them Redskins. So I think that's another piece of history that needs to be said more, is Indians and their sacrifices, you know, mothers sacrificing their sons, people sacrificing their lives for this country, which allows people to just shout Redskins, 80,000 plus.
There's no way to respond to that except to say that, for me at least, except to say that I think one of the things that will contribute in some way to alleviating that problem is this building and the programs that happen here and the fact that people continue to come to visit it and how important that is. Suzanne Harjo and I have been friends for a long time, and I remember when she first was talking about how important it would be to have this museum, and she said it wasn't just important to have this museum, it was important to have this museum here, so that when members of Congress were in the Capitol looking out at the mall, this was the first building they saw. And because of where it is, they can't build any others that are going to block the view.
So we'll take one last comment.
Yes, thank you. The program today has been absolutely marvelous, and I think of similar to recent momentum that is building on the gun issue, how people, there's so many people of eloquence in the room here, and that they've spent the whole day certainly testifies to their great interest. But it seems there needs to be a sign-up sheet and some kind of gathering of email addresses and so forth for any kind of group activity that might follow this, because while everyone in their personal spheres can do their part, group action is really needed on all fronts in all of these major issues to effect change. And I don't know if there's a way that a sign-up sheet can be put outside, or several, that people could put their emails and at least have some linkage with one another if there are any group activities to follow.
I think we should absolutely explore that. So I want to say a few quick words here to wrap up the day and wrap up the panel. I teach at the University of Michigan, which has a stadium, largest stadium in the country, and we 115,000 people, and we cram a few more in. And it's quite a thing, right, to be in that stadium. The feeling of community, of solidarity with other people is incredibly, incredibly powerful. When the team runs out, right, everybody feels it. And I think most people in the room have had those kinds of experiences, the way that we can come together as a community. What we've been talking about, of course, is a moment when we come together in as a community around a certain set of symbols and practices that actually destroy our community. And it's not simply that these things are disparaging for American Indian people and dehumanizing. They are, at their core, because we practice them in this context, they are dehumanizing of us, no matter who we are when we're sitting in that stadium. So these kinds of struggles that we're talking about here, struggles that exist in the realm of culture and meaning and experience and practice, actually really matter a lot. There was a moment, you know, when Karl Marx said, well, look, you know, the economy, the economics of it determines everything, right? It determines what happens with culture floating around in the superstructure. But I think one of the things that we know now is that this isn't really truly the case, right? Economy determines a lot. And we can always go to the economic argument, and we always should, right? But what happens in people's hearts and minds, right? What happens in culture as we become people, in all the instances and places where we become people, including sitting together in stadiums or in auditoriums like this, right? These things produce meanings in the minds of individuals and in conversation with other individuals in all the personal networks that we have, right? They produce our collective sense of culture and meaning and what is right and what is not right. So it's important for us when we're engaged in these kinds of struggles to fight them on all possible realms, the social realm, the economic realm, the cultural realm, the legal realm. One of the questions I think that we always ask in these kinds of circumstances, and it was the main question, it's the implicit question that we all ask, what am I to do? Right? What are we to do? How are we to live our life? What are we supposed to do if we care about this? I started keeping a running tally of some of the ideas that were floating around here today, and I want to thank everybody for being incredibly smart, engaged, eloquent. The panel, fantastic. The audience, amazing. This is an event that really, I think, touches us all. So here's just a quick list. I'll read fast, right? Economic strategies, boycott, sponsors, FedEx, team merchandise, personal pressure, conversations with other human beings. That turns into community pressure at some point. We've had a tweet conversion today. We've heard other tweets that are not about conversion, but maybe they will get there. We have civil rights attorneys, right, who don't actually see civil rights instances right in their own practice, right, in their own home, in their own house. Language, refuse the word, reject the word, watch it grow if this can happen. Is there an economic profit model that can be used, right, to convince team ownership, the NFL itself, right, that yeah, you know, let's get rid of this stuff, make it collector's items for 2 years, fine, we'll accept that trade-off, right, and then we'll have another, you know, fire sale and we'll sell off this new stuff. Could one be convinced around the economic kind of model? Is it possible to imagine, right, that some young athletes, perhaps RG3 during rehab time, will think a lot about this kind of issue and think about the legacies of people like Arthur Ashe, right, or Kurt Flood or other folks, Mike, that you raised in that quite wonderful column that you wrote, actually. Protest. We kind of forget about this stuff that we used to do called protesting. What if we showed up at training camp, if not necessarily the game in the stadium, which seemed to be absolutely prohibitive of this? Mike says this might show up on national news. This might actually be part of this bigger, broader kind of front. Letters and emails. We should write the NFL. Quit supporting this. We should write the Washington Post. And I believe the name was Marty Baron, right? Not to sort of like put you in a position, Mike.
But we could write and say, look.
I'm going to be fired tomorrow.
Yeah, exactly. Mike Wise told me to, just don't use Mike's name on this, right? Right? We write the NFL and we say you should be held to higher standards. We want you to be held to higher standards, right? What about the legal realm? Of course, there's the trademark lawsuit that has made its way through, been refiled, these kinds of things. Other people have suggested lawsuits against those broadcasters who have deals with these stations, who have deals with this team. Are there other legal avenues that we have not yet explored? Of course, there's the moment of popular culture. Someone mentioned Marlon Brando going to the Academy Awards or Jimi Hendrix at Woodstock. And this makes me think of something we haven't talked much about, which is social media. Right? We talked a little bit about sign-on and sort of existing petitions and these kinds of things. But in fact, social media, if we're talking about youth, this is one of these things that I think we absolutely must engage. It's a sign in some ways, right, of where we're sitting generationally in relation to this dialogue. Ebony, we should engage you, right, around these kinds of issues, right, and we should think more about how we use this stuff. And we should talk about the media itself. So Eric and Mike, you've done these kinds of things, but we should ask the Washington Post about this. We should think about education, right? Things that happen in the K-12 classroom can contribute to this kind of effort. Civil rights issues and decisions themselves, right? There is a body of stuff out there, right, that we can continually use and mobilize around this. Perhaps we petition the White House, or perhaps we sign on online. We need to perhaps psychoanalyze Daniel Snyder and figure out just what it is that makes the man tick, because I don't get it, right? All the arguments lean, you know, in a certain direction, and yet he leans in the opposite direction. Psychologists, we need your help here. There is a sense, right, that this also needs to engage the spiritual level. And I think we can say at this institution, we begin each of our meetings with a prayer. We close each of our meetings with a prayer. We take this seriously here. So thinking about prayer, but also moral and ethical seriousness, right, and the ways which we as a collective, as a group of people, bring these things to bear on the world. So, oh, and back to the youth, Ebony, back to the youth. And mobilizing tribal governments, right? Yes, this is exactly right. Tribal governments don't need to be silent on this particular issue. What we're thinking about then, and what we can think of collectively and collaboratively, is a broad-based struggle across all the different kinds of realms of action, right, in which each one of us has some particular role to play, whether it's sending that small email or doing that small Twitter feed or whatever it is, right, the collective kind of mass in action can perhaps establish the conditions for history to change. So I'm a historian, right? And one of the things a historian knows is that stuff actually does change. Like, stuff changes over time. Nothing remains the same. And one of the ways in which things change is good, meaning, and committed people end up establishing the conditions for unexpected things to happen, right? History changes in many, many instances because of stuff that we can't predict. Right, it's contingent. This is what historians say all that. History is contingent, and guess what? The future is contingent as well. We establish the conditions, we make our best effort, and we are open to the thing that we did not expect to have happen. And maybe it's RG3 sitting, you know, with his in a whirlpool with ice on his knee and sort of just thinking a little bit more about this conversation and about the world as a whole. Here at NMAI, we are committed to education. We host discussions like this discussion. I want to thank you all for participating in it. We make knowledge, right, through the enterprise and the kinds of scholarship that we do here around our fantastic collections. We educate people. We're committed to the educational project. And we host awesome receptions out in the Potomac atrium. Let me tell you, you have not been to a reception until you have been to an NMAI reception, and we're going to have one in about 10 minutes. So please stick around, continue the conversation, and we'll be out there.
Professor Deloria, we just wanted to respond to idea of an email. We just created one. Please, everyone, email us at racistsportsmascots@gmail.com. That is also our hashtag. I work for the museum, and we will make sure that you get on the list and get all the resources, the links to this symposium, and everything else we plan to do in the future. racistsportsmascots@gmail.com.
I love this brave new world. Plural. Thank you all so much. Wow. We'll see you out there in the atrium for one of the best receptions ever.
Thank you.